that impossible dream to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to Southland, and to right the unrightable wrong, to love pure and chaste from afar, to strive when our arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable.
Good evening and welcome to CAPtions. What we plan to do this evening is to give you a very special program that will join in progress the remarks made by the Dr. Ralph David Abernathy in a presentation at Jumer's Castle Lodge. And following those remarks, I will give you an update on the status of community action and the services that we're currently delivering here in the Peoria area.
New South Town, no matter how hopeless.
In 1776, Thomas Jefferson and our founding fathers dipped their pens deep in the wells of ink and etched across the pages of history that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men, not some men, but all men, not white men, but all men, not brown men, or yellow men, rich men, poor men, but all men are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, and that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. These words of our Declaration of Independence, the preamble, makes it palpably clear that our rights as citizens of the United States of America come not only from the Constitution or the Bill of Rights, but these rights come from God. And if you are not pleased with America, if you are not satisfied with America, you go back where you came from. Because we do not have any problems with America that we cannot straighten out. I received this note the other day addressed to me. I don't know why the postman would put it in my box, but he brought it to my house and put it in my mailbox just to liver lip. And the card said, "Dear Liver Lip, why don't you organize a movement to take all of the Negroes with a little N back to Africa And if you will organize a movement to take all of the Negroes back to Africa, I will give you $3,000 to buy you some boats. And I will give you $50 to buy you some dashikis. Dashikis was misspelled, Mr. President. So once you get there, you will be the head of the tribe. And it was signed from Whitey. I wanted to bring that card. I had intended to bring it this evening with me, but I forgot it. But I want to tell three things to Whitey. First thing I want to tell Whitey is that you cannot go back where you never been. Long before the Pope got off the plane and kissed the ground, the first time I went to Africa, I got off the plane in Nigeria and kissed African soil. The Popes made the press, but mine didn't make the press, but I kissed the ground because I felt a kinship to African soil. I am not ashamed of my culture and my heritage. I am secure in what I am. I'm glad that God made me black. And I am glad that my ancestors came from Africa. And I have soul, I have feeling, and I can move. I can do the boogaloo. I can dance. Even after two small strokes, I can do it because that is a part of my culture and a part of my background. But I was not born in Africa. I don't know anything about Africa. I was sitting with the doctor right here this evening trying to find out about Africa. I don't know nothing about it. I don't know Africa. I don't know a single jungle, not a single country, and not a single street in Africa. But I know about the dear old United States of America. And that is the greatest country in the world. And I'm proud to be a part of it. The second thing I wanted to tell Whitey, and will you tell Whitey for me? You know, Whitey may, you may see Whitey when you go back to the dormitory. I don't know. You may see Whitey in the class tomorrow morning. I don't know. Racism is alive and doing well in the United States of America. And I don't know where you will see and whom you will see. But where is the press? You get me on television. Get me. I want you to put it in the paper, and you can put it on TV because I want Whitey to know it. That she or he did not offer me enough money. If it is, if I decide to go to Fisk University, Atlanta University, or Spelman College or Morehouse College, and get a group of students in Bradley University, and get some students and carry them over to Africa to study the culture. We are not going by no boat, but we are going first class on 747 jets. And if he wants to make a contribution to my wardrobe, he can help me, or she can help me, with a hard Schaffner and Mark suit. I don't wear that, she can. Since the Poor People's Campaign, I don't wear no dungarees and dashikis. Every day I wear a suit, first class. Young man met me in a rented car, not a rented car, a borrowed car. Young man, and they had a, they said, Reverend, you talking about the plane, but you have not seen the car as yet. I said, Bradley University sent for me in a raggedy car? I said, what are you talking about, boy? And he said, well, they didn't send for you. We borrowed a car, our buddy's car. And so and I said, well, I thought that was kind of strange, but consequently, he said, you just see that car, and the young, I always, Johnny got in the back seat. And he wanted me to get back there. I said, I don't get in the back. No. I ride up front. Ever since the Montgomery bus boycott, I ride up front. And he said, well, that is the death seat. And I said, well, death or hell or anything, I don't care. I will take my chances. Does this thing have a seat belt? And I fastened my seat belt. And Jim drove off, pulled off, with him sitting in the back. I want to tell Whitey, until the Englishman goes back to England, the Frenchman goes back to France, the Italian goes back to Italy, the Irishman goes back to Ireland, the Jew goes back to Israel, the Arab goes back to Lebanon or some other neighboring country. And the white man gives this country back to the American Indian. The black man is here to stay. You can stand up, darling. You can stand up. You can stand up, but don't be ashamed. Stand up. We have to do some things to get our house in order. We have to tell these children. The Lord told me as we were singing this evening, looking down and trying to read, to launch a movement to teach every black boy and girl this black anthem. We don't need to
read it, to sing it. We ought to know it. We learn all of this other often trash. And we ought to know something about our culture and our background. The Jewish community, I applaud them because they will never let their children and their children's children and their children's children, children's children forget the Holocaust. And we should not let our children forget 244 years of slavery with another 100 years of chattel slavery, segregation and discrimination. We must know that we tilled the fields and cleared the new grounds down there in Mississippi. Dr. Jared, you, Natchez, Mississippi, born in the Egypt of America. You and your father tilled the new grounds, cared for the sick, carried the garbage away, forced Eli Whitney into stealing the patent for the cotton gin from a slave. We have to know our culture, and we have to know our background. We better stopping at the Church's Chicken and the Kentucky Fried Chicken and the Burger Kings and Mrs. Winners and all of these chain hot fast food places and cook some breakfast at home, dinner at home, lunch at home, and assemble the family. I don't care who does the cooking. I'm not going to cook because I don't know how to cook, but Ms. Abernathy ought to cook, or I'll cook. I don't care. No. I will get the money. Somewhere I will go to Bradley and get it. But to pay for the cook. But we need to sit down and discuss our family history. Our children today don't know anything about the struggle. In fact, they don't know of anybody but Martin Luther King, maybe. And they have never heard of Jesse Jackson. They have never heard of Rosa Parks, E.D. Nixon, or Ralph David Abernathy. And that is, this is just, Martin Luther King has been dead only 19 years on last Saturday. He died in my arms. They don't know about the struggle because we have not preached it from our pulpits. We have not taught it to them in the family. We must not fall in the pit of having our children to give birth to children becoming mothers. We must not ever turn to dope for the answer. We must live by hope. And it has been proven we can do it.
we must never abandon our teachings of the scriptures and of the Holy Bible. We must live by God's divine word. And when I got ready to go to college, my mama told me, you had better not go to college and make some young lady pregnant, boy. Because if you make her pregnant, you are going to marry her. And you are going to take care of her. And you are going to drop out of college. Because no Abernathy has an abortion. You had better know right from wrong. And she put the fear of God in me and said, not only that, but God is looking at you. And he sees everything you are doing. You cannot hide from God. And I took my girlfriend out one evening. I had a car, and I took her down in the swamps, and Mama's words came back to me. You cannot hide from God. I said, God, are you looking? And I could hear him say, I see everything you do, and I hear every word you are saying. We must spend some time with our families and teach them the way that we should go. We must get all the education that we can. I will never forget, I graduated from Atlanta University, the same institution you graduated from. Dr. Clements told me that if you are going to graduate from Atlanta University, you must be a better student than the students that graduate from Emory University. Those were the days of segregation. And we could not go to Emory, the University of Georgia. Charlene Hunter had not integrated the University of Georgia or Hamilton Holmes at that time. But he said, you must be better. You must be three times better. Because of the racism that exists in America. When the jobs become vacant and they need to hire persons, you have to be three times better than the whites are for you to get the position. We started out behind, but we must catch up. The President of the United States of America is totally insensitive to the needs of black people and poor people in this nation today.
social programs have been cut out and cut back on. Do you still have your program, Ms. Banks? Well, you better thank God for it. Social programs are being cut out. Senior citizens, young man was asking me, Reverend, what are you doing now? I think he thought I was so old that I had retired. And I said, well, I work all the time. I am still on the lecture circuit. And not only am I doing that, I'm the senior pastor of the West Hunter Street Baptist Church. And not only that, I am writing my book that is going to set history straight. I'm dealing with the fifth chapter right now. And not only that, but I am still working to destroy every vestige of the ugly racism that still exists in our nation through the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. I am president emeritus of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, only freed of the day-to-day administration of that organization and financial burden of raising the money, begging it from you. But I have a full-time job. And not only that, I wanted to tell him that I don't feel no ways tired. I've come too far from where I started from. But nobody told me that the road would be easy. But I don't believe God has brought me this far to lead me. I think that is enough. I have given you a $5,000 speech. And I think I ought to sit down now. Don't you think? You suggest yes? Okay. I will bring it to a close now. I will bring it to a close now. Because America never has been America to me. They have sued me for $3 million. Took all of my property away. My family inheritance, my daddy left me 500 acres of rich farm soil down in Marengo County, Alabama. They found it and took that away. They took my car and sold it at public auction. Jailed me 44 times, not for failing to pay my income taxes, not for beating up my wife, but standing up for the justice, the freedom of all mankind. They beat my body till they thought it to be dead. Dumped it out on a lonely Mount Meigs highway. But God sent somebody by that gave me mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, took me to a hospital, and now I stand on higher ground. We have three cars now. A Volvo, a Cadillac, and a Mercedes-Benz. Don't tell me what God cannot do. And if you are right, he will fight your battles. Now,
No, America never has been America to me. I'm through now. I am through now when I tell you. These two little boys had heard of this great philosopher, an old man that lived in the city, who knew the answers to every question that they could raise. And they decided that we are going to catch a bird today, and we are going to find that old philosopher and prove that he will not be able to answer this question. And they caught the bird, and they run running and found the old philosopher. And they said to him, "Tell us, sir, what do we have in our hands?" They had decided if he would answer, "You have a dead bird in your hand," they would open the hand and let the bird fly away. And if he would answer, "You have a live bird in your hand," they would quietly crush the life from the bird, and they would say, "Sir, you have a dead bird in your hand." And so they thought they had him tricked, and they asked, "Sir, tell us, what do we have in our hands?" And he answered, "You have a bird in your hand." And the next question was, "But tell us, sir, is he dead or is he alive?" And he looked down at the ground, scratching his head, as though it was written across the earth. And he looked up in the heavens as though the stars would tell him the answer. And he looked the boys dead in the eyes and said to the boys, "You have a bird in your hand." And they chuckled and said again, "But tell us, sir, is he dead or is he alive?" And he looked again at the heavens and the earth, seeking the final answer. And he looked those boys dead in the eyes, as I look you in the eyes. And he said to them, "The answer is in your hands. The answer is in your hands, whether America lives or whether America dies. Answer is in your hands." Yes, I can say that America never has been America to me. But I swear with all of my oath and my power that I am going to stay on the case and I am going to do my thing until America will be. So right on, and power to the people.
The answer is in our hands if we can accept the remarks of Dr. Abernathy. The answer to the quality of life here in Peoria, the answer to the quality of life in our homes. Much of what must be done is certainly up to us. We hope you enjoyed the remarks that we chose to share with you this evening during Dr. Abernathy's recent visit here in Peoria, where he addressed the Black Student Alliance's participation in what we have come to know here as Garrett Week, where the Garrett Dinner was honoring Dr. Romeo B. Garrett, his 10th anniversary. This segment of CAPtions, what I'm going to attempt to do for you is give you an update of some information regarding the activities over the past few months associated with your local community action agency. It is something that we'll try to do more of in the months and weeks ahead so that you will have an understanding of the nature and role of community action in Peoria. First, let me start by taking a look at the kinds of dollars that were spent here in Peoria in the first 2 months operation of community action. That would be in the months of January and February. The report that has been prepared before me indicates that we spent just a little over $500,000, $556,240, delivering a variety of services and certainly employing over 100 individuals and providing work experience opportunities for those who are not directly employed. For those of you in the viewing audience who have an appreciation for what $500,000 can do to an economy, we think that the expenditure of $500,000 in a couple of months is pretty significant in terms of bringing dollars into the Peoria community and providing jobs. In terms of the current programs that we're operating, I will comment on several of those. Our community food and nutrition program has two or three facets to it. Later on in the program, we'll be sharing with you some footage that was taped during the Canathon, which is a project that we undertake annually where we get the community involved in donating food for our food bank. If we take a look at the Community Food and Nutrition Program in Peoria that is run by the Community Action Agency, essentially what it does, it has, three aspects to it. First off, during the months of January and February, we begin to put together our community garden project, which is a program where we will provide garden plots for families. I think we are in the process now of getting the seeds together, getting the land prepared for the garden plots and getting the applications out to the public and receiving applications for those folk who would like to be involved in the community gardening project. And from what I understand here from staff, applications are coming in and we are in the process of getting that program going. It has been one of our more successful programs in the years gone by, and we have every reason to believe that this year's project will do just as well in terms of our farm operation. I commented briefly on the food bank itself. Let me give you some numbers in terms of the kind of food poundage that was distributed. In January, we distributed to 46 member agencies 88,609 pounds of food to those agencies. In terms of February, we distributed 91,598 pounds of food to 63 member agencies. We are getting food from a variety of sources, not only the Central Illinois Food Bank, but we're doing local solicitation of food. And obviously, last but not least, it was on March 8th that we had our fifth annual Food Share Canathon. We're certainly thankful to the leadership that was shown and provided by Channel 19, as they were very active in terms of setting the tone and educating and preparing this community to deal with the problem of hunger. We consider this year's program a resounding success, and let me give you some of the reasons why. The Mayor's Younger Buddies, which was a level of volunteer participation where the mayor provided leadership, and also a gentleman that's no stranger to you, Mr. Dana Davis, in recruiting over 450 students who were actually there going door to door soliciting food. We had over 225 adult drivers who went out on sites and brought the food and the volunteers to their particular work sites. We had 75 volunteer coordinators for a total of 800 volunteers that day. We have estimated the number of hours that folk put in, and that day generated 2,400 volunteer hours. The door-to-door effort itself accounted for 35,000 pounds of food collected that day. We've also had 17,500 pounds of food donated from various corporate personalities, groups and organizations, for a total amount of food collected related to the Canathon. We have 52,500 pounds of food that is stored in our central area food bank here that will go out as part of our effort to keep the various pantries of our member agencies full and able to meet the needs of the hungry who would be going to the doors of member agencies' food pantries. We also collected on that day $830 in cash donations for those folk who did not have food handy but wanted to be part of an effort to combat hunger in Peoria. So in total, we had 52,500 pounds of food and $830. And it's all because of you. And we want to say thanks again for those of you who volunteered, for those of you who gave, and for those of you who wanted to be involved but couldn't. We want to send out from the staff and Board of Community Action a hearty thank you. In addition to our Community Food and Nutrition Project, we also have a program called our Foster Grandparent Program. And currently, we are at 49 enrollees in the program. Now, what that program does, it provides a way for senior citizens, 55 and over, to be put into a volunteer situation, which gives them something positive to do with their time, and it also provides a financial stipend to complement the fixed income situation that many seniors find themselves on. So in effect, we put them in a situation where they are making a positive contribution to the Peoria community, and in return they receive a financial reward, a stipend, which helps them make it through the day and through the week in terms of financial support. Those 49 individuals are currently employed with us, or should I say participating in a volunteer program. Our Head Start program, which is housed at Webster as our main facility, the Webster School, which we recently acquired, we have there approximately 380 some students in that facility who are being prepared for preschool operation here in Peoria. We also have a site at Tree Wynn, and we also have some home-based locations. The Head Start program, which many of you are familiar with, this past couple of months have had some significant activities in terms of the library opportunity that's been provided some of our youngsters through the bookmobile. There's also been an opportunity for staff and parents to visit local libraries, to take a visit to the Diagnostic Learning Center at Irvin School. And Black History Month was a very significant event for Head Start parents and young people, as there was a great deal of attention given to focusing in on our roots and dealing with the issues of Black history that we think are important as we address the issue of positive self-esteem. So those four, in total, I believe our enrollment is right around 420 young people right now, and we anticipate that that enrollment will stay approximately at that level until graduation. We've also had an opportunity through our Head Start program to participate with Project Chance, which is a program that attempts to get persons involved in public aid back into the mainstream of employment and educational opportunities. So all in all, we're very pleased with the progress we're making there in Head Start. You may hear the term IHEAP used, which is essentially the Illinois Home Energy Assistance Program. What we do there in the months of January and February is we take applications for persons in need of energy assistance. During the month of January, we approved over 1,000 applications. As a matter of fact, in January we approved 101 applications, and we obligated to pay utility bills in the amount of $247,825 in terms of providing assistance to families here in Peoria who were confronted with high utility bills and were unable to pay them. In February, we obligated another $69,380. Year to date, we've taken 2,275 applications that we've approved, and in total, we've taken 3,249. And were able of that total to approve the 2,275 for a total of $563,675, just a little over $500,000 we've been able to pay in utility assistance for persons in the community confronted with utility shut off and or inability to pay the utility bills. So again, as you see here, your regular services from your Illinois Home Energy Assistance Program is at work and doing fine and meeting a very critical need as we've come out of a winter that wasn't as severe as some in the past. Now, we also have a program called Emergency Services, and that's for people who are actually shut off, where we've had the services turned back on before they were shut off. To date, we have taken 76 applications. We've approved 64. It's been a total of $18,717 in having utilities reconnected. A companion program to the regular energy assistance program is our weatherization program. During the months of January and February, our program was not operative in Peoria for lack of funding. We were in a position where we had to lay staff off. As of this particular cable cast, our program has been reinstituted and we have called folks back to work. And we will be reporting in later months on the status of activity levels in that program. our chore and outreach services for the older persons, for our senior community, where we have what we call a chore, senior chore program. I understand that to date we have served 172 seniors and provide a variety of services to senior citizens, from lawn care and maintenance to home care, trash removal, all of those kinds of activities that seniors who've become a little unable to do for themselves, and we've been able to provide assistance to them to help make independent living a reality for them, and a more convenient and comfortable reality at that. On our outreach program, we've provided outreach referral information to some 289 senior citizens. That program is moving along on schedule as well. In our youth employment program, we have provided, currently we have 20 individuals in our work experience program who are participating in the production of cable programming here in Peoria and learning a wide array of skills as they are about producing CAPtions and CAPtions Gospel Hour. As a matter of fact, as we sit here today, it's very comforting for me to look out over the cameras and see a couple of our young men who are at a point now where they are comfortable running the cameras and bringing the image to you that's on your TV screen. So we think that is one of the more positive work experience programs in the city, and we're quite proud of it and the young people who have chosen to take advantage of it, not only in terms of the financial reward that it means to them and their families, but certainly the education and training that they receive is something that they will always have with them. In terms of our small business assistance efforts, we are currently continuing to monitor the contracts that we have that have provided jobs with a number of small businesses in the community who have taken advantage of our low-interest loan program. Our low-interest loan program is a program where we provide low-interest loans to persons interested in expanding or going into a small business venture. We will provide monies at a rate of 3% interest, and in some cases 5% interest, depending upon the negotiations, provided that that person interested in going in business is willing to provide jobs for persons in the community, and the dollars will be going to create jobs through the vehicle of small businesses. For those of you who might be interested in accessing some of our financial services, you should feel free to give us a call here at Community Action, and we will see that you talk to persons responsible for coordinating that effort and getting with you in terms of making some dollars available. In addition to providing direct financial services, we also have a person on board who is involved in assisting with finding local institutions willing to assist small and minority business persons in terms of conventional and or traditional financing. We've begun to initiate a small business venture in the community with some youth, which will be known to you in my next report as a youth economic development venture that will be providing services and job opportunities for young people where they will be in a owner-manager participating relationship with a local business establishment here in town where young people will actually be deciding what kind of products will be sold and getting some first-hand, what we call entrepreneurial training. To prepare young people who are involved with us for that kind of experience, we normally provide entrepreneurial training experience to our work experience candidates in the person of one of our staff members, Mr. Floyd Barlow, who sits in with our trainees and sees to it that they become acquainted with the whole notion about the world of work. So in a nutshell, what I've tried to do is not only bring you a what I thought was a very inspiring message from Dr. Abernathy, but also to give you a community action update. From what I understand, in the recent at-large elections, Peoria held true to its record and continues not to have a black person elected at large. I guess this is a continuing pattern of racism that we see here in Peoria that we're quite concerned about. And I think it should tell us all the more that it is very important that the current voting rights litigation is sound and fundamentally correct, and that what we're going to have to do because of the attitude and the prevailing racism in this community for minorities to get relief in terms of making government work, we're going to have to go into court and see if we can't get litigation completed that will cause district elections and make the voice of black folk in Peoria more meaningful. So what we hope you will do is keep your eye on that situation as well, and not sit back quietly, but make your voices heard. And for those of you who didn't participate in this most recent election for whatever reasons, found yourself unregistered, particularly you young people 18 and over, you need to immediately get involved in getting down to your registration office here in town and get yourselves registered so that you can begin to become a voice. As Dr. Abernathy says, because of the fact that your future is in your hands, one of the processes for you gaining freedom is going to be at the ballot box. You need to get more involved. With that, I'm going to close this particular program wishing you the best. This has been Mike Banks and CAPtions. Good evening.